Hi, my name is Guy Pavello with Far Right Productions. I'm the lead creative and show designer, programmer, and alongside Steve Kidd, producer of Psionic and Rocket League Season 2 wrap-up Kaskade event. This was a two-part performance, with the first tracks being within a true studio environment, but to then merge into Rocket League's championship field, and ultimately culminating within Rocket League's Neon Field world environment. I wanted to create new types of XR shooting and experiences, to create new XR perspectives like over the artist's shoulder, a more broad festival perspective shot, a blimp camera, flyby cameras, and helicopter style shots. We wanted to move out of the XR bubble of restraint and focus on a much grander scale. I felt the need for the show to be time-coded and fully DMX console triggered. This was for repeatability and the fact that we predicted requiring many camera takes of different angles and approaches, as well as knew we wanted a seamless show experience. We controlled hundreds of elements within the Neon Field world, but also controlled and developed over 800 internal custom DMX fixtures to extend the show environment. We investigated a few internal as well as external engine tools and elements, ultimately working with all of it now to create custom internal world control, lighting, and laser fixture type and elements to attain frame rates needed, as well as to create a larger, more immersive experience and look that I was after. We were able to progressively push our custom actors and tools with a step-by-step approach, pushing their limits, seeing what was working and faltering, and constantly creating new fixtures and adjustments as our team programmed the show. We ended up in end with a fully time-coded performance, roughly 110,000 Q triggers, and a common frame rate within the engine of 80 frames per second. We were also able to record all universes of data directly into the Unreal sequencer for any desired sequence burns and camera record demos with full real-time playback. I wanted to use only Rocket League game asset elements within our show. For example, we took things like the car boost element and created it into our own fire elemental pyro. We created a custom audio trigger system to relate and mimic the Rocket League Neon Field EQ system real time to Kaskade's live performance audio. I added in the Rocket League bunny girl as a dancer within the Neon Field area. And we added color, speed, intensity, and opacity control to our originally provided asset from Psionic. We added in more PA towers directly from the Neon World scene. And we added elements like the balloon dog and rubber duck, having them float like a beach ball balloon at a real outdoor festival. Ultimately, as a team, we were able to utilize and push the engine to create a one-of-a-kind type of performance for Rocket League, Monster Cat, Psionic, Kaskade, and ultimately, the fan. The upgraded and clean tools within the engine were paramount to our success and consistently proved to be next level.
Hi, my name is Danny FIRPO from All That Now. I was the XR screens producer for this project, and today we're going to talk a little bit about how Unreal Engine was used in multiple phases of production. So right off the bat, in pre-production, we were working with Guy and the FRP team on the show control and design elements for this project. And we had to create separate branches so that Guy could continue to program and produce the show while we worked on some of the creative front end and technical back end. We were also able to work with the director doing virtual location scouts before we arrived on set and allowed us to find shots both in XR and in our cinematic pipeline. For the on-set XR production, we created both front plate and back plate branches, which allowed us to put elements both in front and behind the DJ and really immerse him inside of the virtual world. What made this tricky is for those iconic reverse shots where we were looking over the DJ's shoulder, we had to flip our front plate and back plate elements because the camera is essentially 180 degrees from where it normally is through the rest of the broadcast. We solved this problem by breaking the project file up into a series of sublevels, which allowed us to easily toggle elements between front plate and back plate, as well as being able to work in parallel with multiple technical artists working on different elements of the scene. Unreal Engine was also used in the post-production phase for those cinematic intro and outro segments, as well as other environmental elements that we injected into the stream throughout the broadcast. This gave us true creative cohesion because Unreal Engine was used from start to finish in this project, and created a seamless production pipeline.
Hello everyone, my name is Berto Mora and I'm an XR specialist at Olivet Now. Today I'm going to talk to you about one of the amazing features that we use to create a fully immersive environment within the Kaskade virtual concert inside of Fortnite. We are able to use the latest virtual zoom feature within the Disguise XR software in order to go beyond the limitations of physical space. This feature was previously only possible within the real-time green screen technology and now possible with LED screen technology. Here we are sending the Unreal Engine environment into Disguise. Within here, we are able to break the boundaries of physical space and extend into the virtual world with the virtual zoom.
Hey there, my name is Jeffrey Hepburn. I am the lead technical artist at Olivet Now. And in this, we're going to be going over how we used Unreal Engine with DMX data to do live virtual production on Kaskade's Rocket League Llama-Rama event. So one of the really cool things about having DMX data in Unreal Engine now is that it kind of bridges the gap between traditional live show LDs and real-time content creation in Unreal. Basically, anything that can be driven with numbers can then be driven and programmed as content. So if you want to drive positions, scales, rotations of objects, particle systems, have it feed in like the value of the emission rate, the number of particles, triggering on, off, you know, the sky's the limit on that front. So for the show, we were using the latest version of Unreal Engine 4.26, which came with some really big improvements to the DMX implementation within the engine, which was super vital for this production. In Neon Fields alone, we had almost 50 custom blueprint actors, many of them being Rocket League assets given to us by Psyonix and then exposed with parameters for live show control. This was being driven by about 7,600 channels of DMX data across nearly 800 individually patched fixtures, which is a ton, but we managed to get all of these running live in real time for the shoot. The DMX testing and debugging tools within the engine were also greatly improved, which made my life as a technical artist much easier because I could then evaluate the performance and functionality of the blueprint actors I was making to ensure that they would work as intended before handing off to the FRP team, which made the whole collaboration process that much easier. So the biggest difference between a virtual production and a traditional in-person live show would just be performance. For a traditional live show, having dozens, hundreds, even thousands of lights on stage really isn't a problem because each of those fixtures is itself its own hardware which will take in DMX commands, interpret them, and carry out those instructions. For a virtual production, this isn't the case, and so you're going to have to be a little bit more clever about your content design in order to achieve real-time performance. Because now you're having to think that all of this DMX data is being sent to a single server, a single CPU, and so that has a lot more performance implications that you have to consider like a game dev more than an LD, where in that case, your biggest limiting factor is just going to be how much data your console can output. But at the end of the day, clever design is going to help you achieve your content goals in a performant manner for real time. As an example of how we achieved this in Kaskade, I'm going to use this marquee trim. Now, we wanted to treat this like a traditional marquee with like hundreds of little bulbs. Ultimately, that was going to be too performance impactful. And so our solution was to actually treat this more like a neon tube with gobos. We had four different gobo layers, each being sent just a couple of DMX parameters. On the material side, we had the different layers with different patterns of gobo shapes. And then the final output is a gobo where we have RGB control for the colors and adjustments on that side, and then different opacity masks for the gobos and velocities to control and layer how we want this dynamic gobo to be interpreted for a real-time fixture. So the big takeaway here is where possible, if you can take what would be hundreds or thousands of fixtures in a traditional show and combine them down into a single fixture with some clever shader design, you can still achieve your content goals, but in a performant manner for real time.